In this final part, we're going to complete the amplifier design. Now, so far, we've designed the input and output matching networks using the input image model. That is, we actually designed the input and output matching networks together, because in fact it is not possible to design those separately and obtain an amplifier with good gain characteristics, noise characteristics, and also be stable. We simplified the design considerably because we used the image model with negative capacitors, negative inductor, and we changed the port impedances as well. And we ended up with just 5 parameters to vary, and we used tuning of those parameters. Yes, we probably could have used optimization, but it was such a simple problem. Tuning did the job. Now, in the final stage, we need to design real input and output matching networks. And we're going to design those independently. They're going to be fairly complex designs. We're not going to be able to design them together, and we're not going to be able to use optimization really either, because the network is going to be so complex, we need to simplify it down. For just the input network on its own, we will select a few parameters to optimize. If we optimize with respect to 5, that is doable. If we try and optimize with respect to 10 or 15 or more, that really isn't possible. We just don't know how to optimize with so many parameters. After we've designed the input and output matching networks independently, we will assemble the entire amplifier, and then we will optimize the overall design, but we'll just pick a few selected parameters to optimize the design. Here is the negative image model that we ended up with at the end of our design. We have a negative capacitor at the input, negative capacitor and negative inductor at the output, and we see that we had to change the port impedances away from the 50 ohms. We had to change the port impedance here away from 50 ohms as well. So 22.9 ohms at the input, 68 ohms at the output. But there are only 5 unknown numbers here. There are two here and one here. There are 5. And 5 is enough that we can use tuning. Now, especially when we're doing the tuning, we are playing around with the input matching network with these 2 parameters, and then separately we can play around with the output matching network and arrive at a solution. Now, we know that the right strategy to use is to work on the input matching network. Once we've got a good result there, we move to the output matching network. Then we can update that by looking at the input matching network. We can repeat that, but it's going to be diminishing returns. So we designed using 5 parameters. And here are the final results that we obtained. We obtained a gain and noise figure curves. So on the top here is our gain curve. Our target was 14 dB gain and a noise figure of less than 1 dB. In fact, our target was 14 dB plus or minus 1 dB. So 14 dB is here, we're within 1 dB until we get to about that point. But we're outside our band now. We only needed to design between 8 and 12 GHz, so we have met the specifications, but of course we needed negative capacitor and inductor values. For noise figure, we needed to be less than 1 dB. Here is 1 dB. We easily meet that target. We're less than 1 dB, quite a bit less than 1 dB. Over that range. Now, we could have used computer optimization, that is true. We could have optimized the value of the port impedances and the 2 capacitors and inductors. But it's such a simple problem, we really appreciate being able to get a feel for our circuit while we're designing it. Now, at this design step, what we really need is a topology that produces a counterclockwise locus with respect to frequency on the Smith chart. Well, perhaps if we could just stand still, that would be good, because a normal passive circuit wants to rotate with respect to frequency in the clockwise direction, and all linear passive circuits will do that overall. Just between 8 and 12 GHz, we either want it to go counterclockwise, or perhaps if we could just get it to stand still, that would be good. Now, we're going to define our design problem a little bit differently, and our image model enables us to do that. Let's go up here and look at our image model, the input side of it anyway, and we see that we have a 22.9 ohm resistor at the port, and a negative capacitor, and the idea is that negative capacitor cancels the capacitance at the input of the transistor. That's our physical interpretation. Then for maximum power transfer, we want 22.9 ohms to be driving 22.9 ohms. Flipping that around, what that is telling us is that the input of the transistor looks like a 0.294 picofarad capacitor. That's the negative of minus 0.294 picofarad capacitor up here, and 22.9 ohm input. We've turned our input network design problem around so that now we are looking in at a 50 ohm port into our input network, and this is the model for our transistor. We want to design so that the input looking into the model looks like 50 ohms. In fact, this is not the input of the image model anymore. We want to put a real circuit into the input network, and the input into that input network at port 1 should be 50 ohms. That's our aim. That's much simpler than trying to get that shape characteristic on the Smith chart. We need to have that in mind, but what we have done is turn the problem around to be a much simpler thing and something that we could optimize for. Let's recall what we are trying to get. We are trying to develop a network here, or a network up here, such that gamma S looking in is just that required to provide something close to conjugate matching of the input of the transistor. Not exactly complex conjugate matching, because of course we have to worry about noise. Basically, this is what we're trying to get. We're trying to get a gamma S curve that rotates counterclockwise at least from 8 to 12 gigahertz. And in terms of our image model, we were able to achieve something pretty close to that. Again, here is our simpler design problem. We have replaced our transistor by a series capacitor and resistor with values that we obtained from the image model design. We want to get this counterclockwise rotation, and there are only a few topologies that give us anything like that. Remember, our normal linear circuit wants to rotate in the clockwise direction. There are some circuits that will tend to rotate in the counterclockwise direction for a little while, for a small frequency range, or at least largely stand still. And one of those circuits is this one here. Designers covet results like this. If they see somebody describing this in a paper, somebody else describing this in a paper, they will capture that topology and file it away. This is the circuit that largely has that characteristic. We're looking from the transistor here. This is gamma S. We're looking into a 100 ohm transmission line with a shunt transmission line, could be open or short, followed by the 50 ohm of the outside world. With transmission lines, we can approximate this result. Now, if you have done filter design, you can also come up with a design using lumped elements that approximately has this characteristic as well. But transmission lines are a much better solution and tend to operate over a much wider bandwidth than any lumped element filter design will. Here is the final realization of our input network. This is the simple design problem that comes from our image model. We're trying to match to a series combination of a capacitor and a resistor. And this is the combination. This is the circuit that does it. We actually have two stubs. We have an open-circuited stub here, a short-circuited stub there. On this side, we would connect that series RC model for our transistor. So we don't see 50 ohms here. But looking in this direction, we want to see 50 ohms. Or, in terms of a reflection coefficient normalized to 50 ohms, we want to see a reflection coefficient that is very small. It wasn't enough to have a transmission line followed by a stub. We end up having two transmission lines and a stub and another transmission line. This is the basic element that we saw from the topology description on the previous slide. We have one basic element here, and here is a basic element here. So we have two elements with that transmission line stub form that gives us the result. In a microwave circuit simulation, we don't simply put a stub out from a transmission line. We need to model that T-junction as well. And there are special T-models in microstrip circuit simulators, in microwave simulators. When we look into this network terminated in our image model for the transistor, we have a gamma in, and gamma in plotted on a Smith chart looks like this. So this is the gamma in plane. It's the plot of gamma in on the Smith chart. Ideally, we would be right in the middle here. Gamma in would be equal to zero if we had a perfect match. Let me take that back a little bit. Maybe not ideally, because of course we may have a little bit of mismatch in order for us to handle noise and optimize the noise characteristics. Now we can look at this input network two ways. We can look at the input reflection coefficient looking in this gamma in, and that is certainly the way we design this and what we look at in design. We can try and tune some of the parameters previously, such as the characteristic impedance of those microstrip lines, or more likely the width and length of them, or we could use optimization to get us there. Another way of looking at it, and this way fits in with our intuition. We don't design to this because it's too complex, but just to make sure our intuition is behaving correctly, we can look at the reflection coefficient looking into the input network from the transistor. This is a rather complex diagram, but we're looking at gamma S here. We're plotting gamma S. Now, I've zoomed in on this on the next slide, but we are looking at the reflection coefficient looking into the input network. Here is the expanded version. Now, I can't put all of the information up here or the actual information up there because it's a little bit complex. For maximum power transfer, roughly we're trying to match S11 conjugate. We can see it going in the counterclockwise direction. This is the locus of gamma S for minimum noise figure as we increase in frequency. And this purple curve is the reflection coefficient looking into our actual input matching network. And we see it does have a slight variation in the clockwise direction, but I've actually had to expand it out from 6 to 14 gigahertz just so that we could see it. Our actual design is from 8 to 12. If we had a regular passive network here, we would see a tremendous variation going around here. We're going over half an octave, of course, so there would be quite a big difference. Here we see that going from 8 to 12 gigahertz, we have largely stood still, and we're around this region of optimum noise performance. We follow the same procedure in developing the output network. Again, we have this characteristic transmission line section here, followed by a stub, which gives us that type of characteristic that we want. The reflection coefficient looking into the output network from the outside world. Remember, this is our model for our package transistor now. We have a positive capacitance, positive inductance, and a resistance, and this comes from our image model. So looking into the output network from the outside world, ideally we should see 50 ohms if everything is really well matched. And look how good we are. 8 to 12 gigahertz, we just loop around that origin point where the reflection coefficient is equal to zero. It reminds you a little bit of a filter design. We're near the very final stage of design now. So far, we have designed the input matching network using the input image model, and we use tuning of parameters. We also designed the output matching network using the amplifier image model, and we use tuning of parameters. In fact, we designed the input and the output matching networks together because there were only 5 parameters to tune. We started off by just tuning the input network, then we went to the output, then we go back to the input, and you don't need to iterate very much to get a fairly good design. In the final stage, we're going to assemble the entire amplifier. We will take the real input network we've designed, the transistor, and the real output network we've designed, we'll pull it together, and then we will do optimization of the whole design. But we will only select a few parameters to optimize. We cannot optimize all of them. It will simply take too much time. Here is our final result. Here is our amplifier with an input network and an output network. Here is our final gain and noise figure results for our circuit with real input network and output network. And this is what our design will look like. We have our transistor in here. We have via connections to the backside substrate. Those connections are from the source to the backing ground. We have RF input. This is a 50 ohm line here. We'll see one stub and a second stub and another high impedance line. We have a high impedance line here. We know it's high impedance because the width is much narrower than the 50 ohm lines. So we have a length of transmission line here. We have a stub, and then we go out through our 50 ohm line. In an actual design, we may meander this output line so we take up less room. So we've clearly met our specifications. So we have a great design and a very methodical process in order to arrive at what could otherwise be a very complex design.